Everyone, good to have you here tonight. We got those here and then those who are watching. Got a few people with COVID that weren't able to attend. So this is probably going to be a little bit, it might look a little unorganized because we've never had the banquet or the football banquet here in the sanctuary. But I would love to thank First Baptist Church. Give them a round of applause. So grateful that we were able to have this. What a crazy year. I mean, it still hasn't ended, it doesn't seem like. But, I'm proud of everybody hanging in there. As Chuck Nelson often says with his great Confucius-type quotes, we're hanging in there like a hare in a grilled cheese sandwich. We have definitely persevered this year. It has been a difficult task. And I want to thank so many people for their combined efforts that make it possible. Working in this city or working in this town, the combination in the togetherness of our city and our school system are just really remarkable. You talk about perseverance. I mean, we see it every day. We talk about it with our kids every day, all the things that we have to go through and fight through. And I want to recognize somebody tonight. If Miss our mayor, Sherry Sullivan, would stand up. Six years ago, I came, and you're talking about a salesman for the city of Fairhope. I came here to interview for the coaching job, and at the time, she was working as the assistant, and you're talking about somebody whose eyes burn with passion for the city of Fairhope. It was exciting. She got me fired up, and then there was another lady, Miss Sharon Pippen, who just intimidated me because she handed me a packet that day and started asking me when I was going to have things done, but I'll never forget, and we all know we go through trials, but God's got a plan and tickled to death. You kicked your campaign off this year. I think it was at a football game, wasn't it? Awesome. Good to have you there. And it's good for you to be here tonight. And talking about our city, our council, all our council members, Parks and Rec, Pat White and that group, our police force and putting our officers in our schools and leading the way of getting guys like Shane Nolte, David Miller, Ron Wells, Bucky, all of those guys in our schools has really made a tremendous impact just on the day-to-day flow of things, and so proud of that. Our school board, Mr. Cecil Christenberry, who heads up the Baldwin County School Board and all the positives that he does. I played for Eddie Tyler, and I love Coach. He was a mentor to me long before he became the superintendent. And then Mr. John Cardwell and his team. Mr. Cardwell is, he's got a job nobody envies sometimes. I mean, he is, but you talking about somebody who'll go to the mattresses with you. I tell you what, he is a great guy, and I think the world of him. I've worked for four or five different principals, and he's by far the best. A lot of other people that help us on Friday nights and those, pull those games off. Our booster club, Mr. Cortinas retired this year. He even did the booster club president a couple years before when his sons had graduated and moved on. It's just that kind of sacrifice. Mike Ball that comes and does the stadium and all the crew that helps him. Pirate Nation Live, we were kind of the innovator Fairhope was of providing the games to the people in the public and doing it free of charge. A couple years ago, we had to go to the NFHS network, but they pioneered that, and people like Eric and Jack Burrell and guys that make that, Dez Joyner, that make that possible. I really appreciate what they do. And there's so many other guys. This year we really went fast paced. Joel had us rolling and our offensive guys. And I was worried about our chain crew, Don Pippen and them. I didn't know if they were going to make it. I thought Ben Blackman, Spanish Fort coach, was going to have an aneurysm yelling at the referees about how fast we were moving the ball up and down the field. And our chain crew was right there with them. So I'm proud of those guys for sucking it up. The dynamic duo, the Grillers, Charlie and Joe, And then also Miss Karen Vance, who has filmed, I think, almost 20 plus years. She goes to Fairhope football games and films because she once did it when her children were playing, and she just keeps coming and going. And I appreciate what she does because she's great video for our guys. Bayside Orthopedic has been a great addition too. You know, they've been team doctors for a long time. And we're grateful. Dr. Dederman kind of takes the lead in that group now on the sidelines on Friday nights. But for example, right now they're doing physicals at the school. Don't charge us a thing. They show up and they'll be doing that tomorrow. And you know, that's just a great service. And then our trainers, Marley, Josh, I think they're here. Stand up. And they work with Encore, and that's been a great addition that we made in the last 5 or 6 years that really make that possible for us to have two trainers on site to deal with injuries that we all know happen with athletics, and it's great to have them. I also want to thank our football committee. We actually, a couple years ago, you know, my thing is that I always wanted to keep the cost of playing for an athlete as low as we could. And you know, we got great businesses in this town, and we're going to have them. You'll see some sites that you can stay attuned to stay up with the football news that's going on. We'll have those at the end, and we're going to list all those businesses on that site. And you know, if you can remember them when you get ready to look for one of those services, we'd certainly appreciate it. I do want to mention a couple. Bob Bumhauer and Spencer feed our football team every Friday for no charge. I'm going to tell you, it would cost me $1,000 to feed this football team or a pregame meal. They do it every game. I want to give a hand to those guys. They've done that now going on. Really, they did it before I was here, and about 5 years ago started back, and I just appreciate that so much. And there's so many people that I can't mention them all, and this is a little bit of a different setting tonight, but just thanks to all our businesses. You know, Terry Thompson, the Booths, Vince and Lynn, and just all the businesses. I won't even begin to mention them all, but we're going to list them on there so you can make sure, and we're greatly appreciative. The people on the committee, Martin Myrick, Megan Thomas, Rick Pfeiffer, Chris Lipscomb, Phil Azar, Eric Williams, Dennis Painter, Luke and Jessica Vanderwall, they raised about $40,000 for our football program through these businesses by soliciting and bringing people in. And you know, that's a direct savings to our kids. And this year was critical. Our revenue was cut by more than half on gates because of the limited number of people that we could have. And I just want to let you guys know how much we appreciate that and how important it was. Parents feeding us on Sundays. That's why I'm in, you know, Cutback, Alabama or whatever, Scaleback. I think I weighed 250 the other day thanks to some of those Sundays meals that we were able to feed our coaches. It's important that, you know, we stay up there pretty long hours on the weekend. We certainly appreciate that. Another guy I want to mention, you don't even maybe know Bill Stemridge, and I don't know if Bill's here tonight. Bill cooked breakfast every morning. Now the church has paid for it, but Bill, I just never knew what the kids were going to eat for breakfast because it was such a variety coming in. I asked Miss Pippin, I said, can we just kind of come up with a menu that I know I'm going to get, the kids will get a good meal in them first thing in the morning on game day. Bill cooked for 120 kids 11 times this year and had it there by 7:15 every Friday morning. And I'm so grateful for that because it's really important. And our kids know they're treated first class. And our cheerleaders have pendants made for them every game on Friday that the boys wear around school, every player. Thank y'all for that. I think we did them for y'all 1 year to go to. They were horrible, weren't they? Not only are they ugly, they're not very artistic. But I also want to mention our coaching staff. You know, this is another year when we talk about persevering and fighting through things. I got a good group of men that I'm able to work with. They're good fathers. They got good hearts. They're godly. They're tough. I'll give you an example. Two of our coaches this year lost their dads. Going to those funerals and just seeing the impact, they never missed a beat. Our kids would have never even known it if I hadn't told them about it. They care. And that's the most important thing to me. They care. And I want you to give them a round of applause, our coaching staff. You know, a lot of the wives aren't here tonight because of kids, and this is a little bit different scenario, and we're trying to limit crowds, and we've got a few here. They are so supportive. Now, when I say that, don't think that they don't fuss at us, okay? Because, yeah, we get fussed at during the season. Times they kind of get a little short fuse. Not you, Dotsie. But, you know, I'm grateful. My wife kind of knew what she was getting into because I coached a little bit in college, and we've been dating since high school, and you know, she signed up for it, and she always says that, and you know, but I want to thank our wives for the time that they spend and without us and having to raise kids and the things that they do. Give it up for them, please. And I know I left somebody out. I know I probably didn't mention somebody. Gosh knows we're grateful, I promise you. And we definitely love, Fairhope's a special place, it really is. Probably just takes some, you gotta go somewhere else to come back maybe sometimes to realize that. But you know, it's a great place to be. I mentioned her earlier, but Miss Sharon Pippen, who's up in the booth tonight, who's been working on videos probably since December, who organizes all of this and takes pictures and posts them on websites, and she loves Fairhope, and she loves the kids of Fairhope. And I want to give her a hand here. So tonight, sit back. I know it may take a little while, but we're going to talk about these kids. We're going to because we do love them, and they have all, boys and girls, made a great sacrifice for a worthy endeavor, and I think that's extremely important. And hopefully, by being a part of a team and a group, they've learned something that they'll take and share and impart upon somebody else later in life. I get tickled this year. I pulled out on the football field, and I've got three players that graduated in 2017 coaching a youth league football team. They're already back working with young people. It did my heart good. And you know, these people have made a great sacrifice. So sit back and enjoy as we watch our cheer video from this year. Thank you.
So when 4 out of the last 6 years, you guys have seen me in some type of cast. December is my surgery month officially, so. Okay, I started writing this kind of like a letter to my girls a couple of years ago, and it's just easier for me to say what I need to say that way, so we'll go ahead and start. My dearest beauties, thank you for committing to a sport with no true off season and committing to try out for a team where we were not even sure if we'd even have a season of any kind. COVID hit us before we ever tried out, and I called it our Corona timeout. We were at home. We weren't really sure what we were going to do, and Coach Carter and Mr. Cardwell and I, we talked about it and worked with UCA, and then we decided, okay, we're going to do video tryouts. And so they learned everything online, and then they submitted everything through video, and I'm praying we never have to do that again. But they still signed up for it, knowing that no idea. And then we practice and we get ready for camp, and then we can't go to camp. And so they've definitely had some bumps in their road. Cheer is different than any other sport in that we spend the entire year together. We don't have an off season at all, like I said. I'm certain that they spend more waking hours with me than they do with their families during the week. Cheer is truly a sisterhood. It's something that most of them have done since they were teeny tiny, and they just continue it through. They argue and disagree like sisters, and they fight like sisters. I have a sister, so I think I can say that. They also encourage each other like sisters, and they protect each other like sisters. They protect each other's integrity and honor like you would not believe. And they love hard like sisters. And they'll tell you, and Jerry will tell you too, in a heartbeat, I become their mama bear. I've heard him in the hallway go, oh, don't you mess with one of Coach Brewer's girls, because I'll come after you. So cross or hurt one of them, and then you get a shade or two of Tammy. That's what they call me when my head starts to spin. They named her. As a cheerleader, we're accustomed to staying very busy. We go from football season to basketball season the very next week. As soon as football season's over, the next week we start basketball. Then competition season is squeezed in the middle somewhere, and then as soon as basketball season ends, it's time to get ready for tryouts. And then we prepare for tryouts. Tryouts are always the week prior to spring break. They go to spring break. The Monday we get back from spring break, it's fittings, and we have fittings. And then we start putting our stunts and our stunt groups together and practicing and getting ready for our spring game. We do get to take the month of June off each year, but then that's it, because they come back in July and we're preparing for camp. And most years we do have some competition at camp. This year we had to bring camp to us, so it was just us. But normally they have boot camp for hours a day through the month of July, and then we go to camp, and then school starts, and then it's football season. So these girls commit to an entire year when they try out, and it's a never-ending season, but really I don't think any of us would have it any other way. Like I said earlier, tryouts for 2021 were like no other for us. Dances and cheers were learned through videos. Tumbling was practiced in yards through Fairhope because all the gyms closed down. And then the videos of dances, cheers, jumps, and tumbling were all submitted for hours and hours of our viewing pleasure. Coach Weeks and I met with two of our tumbling coaches for a marathon tryout video watching party, we called it. We had paper. It was all throughout my living room. We tried to, be socially distanced and just right. We started at about 6:00 watching them, and we finished tallying scores a little after 2 a.m. It was a long time, and I think that because we had the opportunity to go back and look again, and double check and all of that. But I am asking, in the name of all things holy, that we can go back to old-fashioned tryouts this year. Darling girls, thank you so much for your leap of faith and your shared love for cheer, as well as all of the sports that we support. They genuinely love football and basketball and the things that we get to do and the things that we get to see and the boys that we support. They take ownership in them, and they are our boys too. Thank you for your endless hours of sign painting, pennant making, teacher treat making. Most of y'all don't know this. The girls feed our teachers every game day. We create snacks, and it's teacher game day appreciation. And they do that on their own. Conditioning, stunt building, tumbling, cheer and yell practices, 5-minute planks, working through illnesses and injuries. And this year's been like every other sport. We've had to bounce around with that. And thank you for doing much of these things from your bedroom or living room this year. Thank you for practicing your skills throughout the pandemic, hurricanes, school closures, and heartache. Your dedication and resilience inspires me and warms my heart. Competition season did not go as planned this year. We took for granted the fact that we have an amazingly talented team off the charts. I've been doing this a long time, and by far the most talented team I have ever had. And it was a routine that was beautiful on Wednesday, and then fell apart Thursday at the Mobile Civic Center. It just wasn't our day, and sometimes that happens. We hadn't really experienced anything like that before, so we took a new appreciation for being resilient. It just wasn't for us. It also wasn't for any of the teams. None of the teams in our division scored well enough to go to state, which was a 70. And because of that, they just took the top two scores. We were 3. But it was a sobering and heartbreaking moment. I'm certain that we all walked away with a deep respect on how things change in an instant. Our beautiful Maddie, who was flying for the first time this year, took a spill on the warm-up mat, and it was scary, and I was certain I was calling an ambulance. It was something that we just couldn't recover from. It shook us to our core, and I'm proud to say that if you're going to mess up and fall apart, girls, I'm glad it was over the concern and loved one for one of your sisters. Now, let's introduce some girls. I don't talk about all of my girls. I just talk about the seniors. We're going to start by just introducing sophomores, then juniors, and then I'll give you a little tidbit on my seniors. Okay, sophomores. My assistant coach, Elise Weeks, has a sick child. She had a 3-year-old with a fever, so she's not here today. I think they had that under control. We're just gonna let them do it. Okay, sophomores. All of these girls cheered on JV last year. When I came here 6 years ago, we made a decision to allow girls, once they try out, even sophomores, if their scores are high enough, they can make a varsity team. Prior to that, juniors and seniors were on varsity, freshmen and sophomores were on JV. And so we switched that up a little bit, and these were sophomores who had scores high enough out of all of the scores to make the varsity team this past year. And we'll start with Ann Darby Clark. Madison Frazier. I will say this little one has battled injuries 2 years in a row, and she just sticks it out, man. She's a fighter. Renee Kennedy. Grace Ann Middleton. Riley Seeley. This one battled a few bumps too, and she never stopped. She came to every single practice, no matter how bad she felt. And Vivian Webster. And so that's quite an accomplishment out of all the people that we have try out, that these sophomores had scores high enough to make a varsity team. So well done. Our juniors, Camille Bailey. She is a junior, but this is her first year cheering for Fairhope High School, so she's lettering tonight as well. Kate Bezzaretti. This was her 3rd year with us. McKenna Bullard. This was her 2nd year. She joined us last year. Anna Grace Johnson. She's been with us all 3 years. Maren Lester. She's lettering this year too. She actually came to us from a school that you guys would know very well. And she came after tryouts and she said, "Coach Brewer, I just want to be involved somehow. I'll do anything." And I said, "You want to be our manager? You can be my gopher. You can carry bags. You can." And she was like, "Sure. Yeah, yeah, yeah." And she did. I mean, she never complained. She did everything. And then she tried out and she tumbles like crazy and we are glad to have her. Paulette is lettering this year too. Leah Catherine Peacock, this is her third year with us. Ella Pruitt, also her third year. Hannah Santos, this was her second year. Savannah Smith, her third year. Maymay Trotter, her second year. Campbell Valence, this is her first year as a junior to cheer for Fairhope High School, and we were very glad to have her as well. She's really great on the mat and strong, super strong. And Emma Grace Vinoy, this is her third year with us also. And so here are your juniors. Okay, seniors. I'm gonna call her by her given name because I know, where's her mother? Yeah, I know that this will please her mother. So Mary Catherine Carrick, we call her MK. But Mary Catherine, MK cheered with us her freshman year and then returned to try out for her senior year. She sent me an email last year and said, "I think I want to try out." And I said, "Send me a video." Super talented, and we were glad that she came back. So she's lettering this year. She is a super strong base and competitive on the tumbling mat. And she actually proved that she's got a hand in choreography, too, this year. MK lettered, and this was her first and only year on varsity, so that was exciting. Angelina Chung, our Angie. This one keeps us laughing. She's so silly. Her heart is as pure as her tumbling is perfecto. She is one of the strongest girls on the mat. And she did not cheer with us her freshman year. She came to us and said, "I've never cheered, I've just tumbled." And I said, "Well, let's see what you got." And then we went, "Yes, you're trying out, please do." It took me a minute to figure this one out though, because she's kind of quiet, she kind of sits back. But once I did, Angie has become one of my very favorite people. Maddie Erdos is not here tonight, she is ill. But she cheered with us her freshman year and her sophomore year, did not cheer with us her junior year, came back, tried out, and cheered with us her senior year. Maddie Farr has cheered with Fairhope for 4 years. This year we dared her a little bit, or maybe we forced her, twisted her arm, to go up in the air. She became a flyer her senior year, which is a big deal. It's like changing from quarterback to lineman, maybe, or vice versa. I mean, she completely changed everything that she did. Okay, whatever, something like that. It was a big change. You get what I'm saying. It's not easy, that was my point. And God love her, she was so scared every time she went up in the air, literally. She was shaking, you know, and I was like, "Are you okay?" "Yes, ma'am, I'm fine. And Coach Brewer, did you see that?" "I did see that, you did great." She took a nasty spill on the warm-up mat, and it was one of those things that we watched, you know, just happen. You couldn't stop it, she was right there. It was, anyway, I can honestly say in all of my years, I've never been so shook all the way to my core. And I was ready to call an ambulance, frankly. And she said, no. She wanted to stay. And her main concern was her team, and she opted to stay. And of course, we cleared that with Marley and her mama. And she watched from the coach's area. And I'm certain that she was crying more out of concern for her team than for herself. This one is selfless. And I love you for that, Maddie Farr. Molly Walding. Molly has cheered all 4 years for Fairhope. She is our go-to for so many things. She's super organized, a little OCD in some areas like me, and I appreciate and value that. I even use her as a description, and I'll say, girls, I want you to arrange it the way Molly would. Put your backpacks the way Molly would. And they know what that means, which is amazing. She's our resident sign and letter writer, and she's willing and ready to do anything we ask her. She has been riddled with injury and surgeries over the past couple of years. She never stopped or wavered in her duties, even from texting. She was, you know, what can I do from home? She also represented Fairhope High School and Fairhope Cheerleading as the Peach Dogwood Trail Maid this year, so we're super proud of that. And we're just proud of her, and we're proud to call her one of ours. My captains this year were Ellie Rockwell and Piper Henley. A candidate for captain must have cheered all of their years at FHS and must be an upcoming senior. The road to captain begins with a letter of interest. I like to see their writing skills. And the girls have to handwrite a letter to me explaining their desire to be captain and why they feel like they're the best candidate. Then with that, we take their tryout scores and tally those up. And then it's followed with a panel interview with me, the assistant coach, and tumbling coaches. And then we have a vote by their sisters. So these two actually had the very highest tryout scores out of all the people that tried out, and they won their sisterhood vote by a landslide, and that says a whole lot about their ability to be captain. Ellie, she's easy to talk about. She's solid as any teenager I've ever known. She's wise way beyond her years. Besides being a talented athlete, she also does track, y'all. And cheerleader. She's driven by a strong moral compass, and because of that, she's highly respected by her peers, and I think I love that most about her. Ellie began suffering from migraines this year, and she learned she needed surgery. Her commitment to her team was so great, she opted to wait until the Christmas holiday break so that she wouldn't miss anything. And as a coach, you just appreciate that kids want to hang out and do exactly what they need to do and be there for their teams, and even if it's self-sacrificing. She's so strong and so driven. She exhibits amazing self-discipline and was a wonderful captain. Is a wonderful captain. Our season is still going. Piper. Piper has also cheered for us all four of her years at FHS, and I'm going to be super honest. She knows this. I've said it before. Piper was my biggest surprise in years and years. Her first 2.5 years with me, she was silly and goofy, and she played super skittish in the air, skittish with her tumbling. And she's a beautiful flyer today. You would never know by seeing that. But she was always like, I can't. And we did all kinds of crazy things, like tie things special and put them underneath the tongue of her shoe. And if she had that, then she believed that it was going to be okay. Anything that worked, we did it. And then all of a sudden, she just blossomed, like overnight. She used to refuse to try new things, and she struggled with her confidence in the air. And then last spring, it was like, boop. Of all the girls, Piper was the one who kept in contact with me during our Corona timeout several times a week. How are you doing? What are we doing? What do I need to do? Can I help you with anything? And that was impressive to me. She still checks in with me regularly. Piper bought herself a planner and started acting like a leader, like before we even chose our captains. She's still a little silly and a little blonde for being so brunette, but I feel like I can legally say that. But I love her something fierce. Watch out for her. This one's planning to continue her cheerleading career next year, so go Bulldogs. I didn't mean it. I just said it for her. Okay. Many coaches love their teams, and they say they love their teams, but I do love these girls. My children are grown, and so this is more than just a job and something extra I do on the side. I do it because I love them, and I love what we do. In all honesty, it's really hard for coaches sometimes to say they truly like their teams. Last year was super easy to like. This year's team was an absolute blessing. With all of the adversity that we faced, it seemed like every time we turn around, something was changing, and they just rolled with it. So they doubled my blessing. This year's group of girls has truly been the easiest to coach and get along with out of all of my years, and I'm not young. Thankfully, we've avoided team drama to the best of my knowledge. If there's been any, they hit it well. And I think it's because these girls have a fondness of each other and a true commitment to the sisterhood that is Fairhope cheerleading. They've bounced back from every punch that's been thrown at us, and I'm crazy kind of proud of their never give up spirit. Parents, thank you for your hours and hours over years of carpooling, baking, sitting in the rain, sitting in the cold, patience with schedule changes and facility changes, late nights, tailgating, tailoring, fundraising, vinyl making, program organizing, party hosting, encouragement and support. Even more rare than liking your team is truly liking the cheer mamas, and this was a rare year, and I felt blessed by them. Last year, we had a few hiccups and jabs in our program, and these mamas rallied their wagons to protect the integrity of the team. I had no idea how deeply the love and support ran in our cheer family, and I'm honored to have their support and their friendship. Varsity parents are proof of amazing parenting, and it's lived out through your kiddos right here day to day. They are good people because you are good people. People ask me all the time, like, how in the world do you teach high school? Oh my gosh, high school, teenagers. I'm like, no, teenagers are the same. Parenting has changed. And I'm thankful to say that you guys are doing it right. Thank you for sharing your most precious gift with me. Thank you for all that you've instilled in them that makes them great students, great cheerleaders, great teammates, great ambassadors for Fairhope High School. Thank you, Mr. Cardwell and Coach Carter, for choosing me to be part of all of this 6 years ago. Like all coaches would probably say, this year has probably been the most difficult as a coach in general, but I have never felt more loved and supported by a team of parents and a team of girls. Girls, you are a team with hearts as beautiful as your faces and talent beyond measure. Talent that gives me a firm belief that Fairhope High School will still compete with the best teams in Alabama and that you will be back next year. I believe in you and I believe in your talent. We're on the map and we're on their minds, and I still believe that. I could not be prouder of who you are, each of you, and I love you more than I could ever express. Go Pirates.
Thank you, Coach. Thank you, girls. Phenomenal job this year. Now we're going to talk a little bit about the football team. And, you know, the challenge this year was good to great. It was something we talked about and something that we really had thought over as a group. And good to great meant more than just let's have a great football team. It meant more than just the athletic side of it. We wanted to challenge them academically. We wanted to challenge them spiritually. And we had a good plan. Coach Messina and our weight room and all our coaches sat down and talked about, we divided them in competitive teams. We're getting ready to have a competitive off season. The kids really started out working hard. The year was going great. We had a great start to January, on into February, really excited. And then COVID hit. Chaos and confusion became the theme of the day. March, we closed down, we had no contact with our players except through email and through a virtual setting. No idea if we'd even play. I mean, we talked about, we fought for it and fussed and argued, and this went on into May. And at May, we started to get, maybe we'd have a season, but we had no idea when we would be allowed to start. Finally, on June the 14th, we were able to bring the boys back in there together. Now, during this whole time, this 2.5 month layoff, the guys didn't have anywhere to go work out. We had some guys that went and converted a warehouse into a weight room. That's how desperate they were to train. It's a great thing about athletics. It brings out the best in people. And these guys wanted to do, but were not able to. And we couldn't as coaches do anything with them. State mandate and you know, I went to the office every day. I know I wasn't supposed to, Mr. Cardwell. I did. I went in the back door, came across the athletic fields. And sometimes I just found myself sitting and staring at the walls because, you know, we were excited about what we had and what we thought we could do, but we couldn't do anything. We were even trained how to take a temperature. We shot them with these guns, and it's always like 96.8. We got some guys on the verge of death. I mean, I don't ever think I saw one register high. I really don't, you know, except Bruiser when he walked across the parking lot in the morning. His might have been a little bit high, all right? But, you know, I mean, it was so frustrating. We sprayed behind them. We did everything we had to do, and evidently it was successful because we had very few kids that were diagnosed with COVID over that time period. But anyway, we made the best of it. We also introduced two new coaches to them when they came back. Coach Williams and Coach Ernest had been added to the staff, so we had some transition. But anyway, we entered the fall camp, and you know, here were the sophomores that were coming in. They had no spring training. They are now thrust into varsity football. They've had no contact. We really are trying to figure out where they fit, but we only got 3 weeks because we play. It was very difficult. It really was. But our kids handled it well. And we were so excited for a Thursday night opener. We sold less than half the stadium. It was a great atmosphere. And our kids played really well. They were so glad to be out. Stadium was far from packed. But oh no, our kids were excited. So they went down there and sat close together. We played great. Well, we won 45-34 versus Spanish Fort. It wasn't even that close. We want it going away, and Friday we come back in and get to hear about it's not how well we played and how well we started everything, it's how close our kids sat together without a mask on. That'll tell you a little bit about the world sometimes, you know? Not the achievement that was praised, it was a little side note, but the big story was how, you know, but I'll tell you what, I went to some games on Friday night that was a whole lot worse than our game on Thursday night, but it was the first one, it was the first opportunity to make a story, so they did. But it was a great start. The next week we went to Andalusia and won. We didn't play great, but we did what we had to do on the road. And then in the third game, we had a major setback. We did not play well at Daphne. We were not ready to play. We ran into a buzzsaw. It was my fault. And we got beat. And they were waiting for us. And we'd beat them 3 years in a row. They had been upset. And we didn't play with them. Well, they were a good football team. They were 9-1 this year. They had a good football team. But we could have played them better. And I didn't have them ready to play. Well, let's add some more confusion. Because the next week, here comes Sally. Sally rolls in. Games are canceled due to the hurricane. And I know you guys went through a lot of hardship. All of us did. It hit us hard. We're shut down for a while, and our kids held it together. Another little stumbling block, but they came back the next week, and they played really good against MGM. We won 45-6. And then we had one circle with Theodore, the game that we really wanted to win, we needed to win. And for 2.5 quarters, we played the best football game we played this year, up 14-3 despite a lot of mistakes and penalties. But you can't turn the ball over 3 times and beat a team of that caliber. They were 9-1 as well this season. And we ended up losing in the end. That kind of put us behind the 8-ball because now we were kind of battling uphill, and our kids did. We go to Baker and on the road beat a very good team, a playoff team, 24-13. We then play two good games, two weeks in a row, against two teams that we should have beaten, and we did. Bryant 45-19, Murphy 35-0. And probably played really one of our better games on senior night at home. And then we had to go play one of the better teams in the state at their place on the road, and they always play better at home. And we lost to Central 49-21. The season finished 8-3, and, you know, it was a good year. It was a really good year in terms of what we have done traditionally here. We've had, since the split and the creation of Daphne and then Spanish Fort, Fairhope has always kind of been trying to get over that hump. Had a couple of 10 win seasons, but you know, it was not what we had wanted. But I'm not disappointed in this group. I'm extremely proud because I think they gave great effort and they never gave up. They persevered and they fought hard. And at times it wasn't our best effort. We had our highs and we had our lows. But, you know, I think that the things that they dealt with to continue on was truly impressive. And I'm proud of them for that. And tonight we're going to talk just a little bit more. I didn't introduce the coaches earlier because tonight I'm going to get them to get up and talk a little bit. So as they come forward, they're going to talk a little bit about their players. So if our offensive coaches will come up and our quarterbacks will move to the side over there, we're going to make our player introductions.
There you go. Quarterbacks, y'all just make your way there. You know, Tim and I work together really, really well. It's the first, we've known each other a long time, but never have really coached together. But this is just another prime example. It's one of the few times at my height I've never had to adjust the microphone. And so that tells you Tim and I literally work, you know, we see everything eye to eye. So jokes ain't getting no better, so y'all can laugh or not. All right. Talk about our quarterbacks here. Let's start with the underclassmen. Let's start with the underclassmen. I got one, Matthew Young. COVID has got him this evening. So I'm sure you're watching on Pirate Nation, Matthew. Try not to embarrass you, brother. He's a young man. He shows a lot of potential as a quarterback. I really like him because he loves to compete. He is constantly seeking coaching. And every day he's asking me, how can I improve my skills? So look for a lot of great things out of Matthew Young. Hope you get well soon, buddy. Another underclassman. Ian Parrish, y'all come on up. Ian is a really, really hard-working young guy. He shows up, you know, what I really love about Ian, he shows up every day with a great attitude and a smile on his face, and he's ready to go to work. It don't matter if it's weight room, running, on the field, skill work, whatever it is. He's a fun guy to coach and to be around. Ian did a really good job on our junior varsity team this past season, and we really look forward to watching his continued development. All right, next underclassman, Caden Creel. Caden's one of the most versatile athletes on our team. He played running back, he played wide receiver, he played wildcat quarterback on offense. He began the year starting on defense. He was also a kick returner. He's an extremely fierce competitor, and he has a tremendous work ethic, and he is truly a student of the game. And I mean that in every sense. You know, sometimes that's coach talk. Let me tell you about Creel. I'll be sitting there watching a game, whether it be college TV, since or college or NFL on TV, you know, since our season ended. And me and my buddies know we're not going to call or text each other during a game. We're focused on the game, watching it. And all of a sudden, my phone will bing, and my wife, Martha, look at me and said, it's Creel, isn't it? Yep. And so all of a sudden, Caden has sent me a play. He has videoed it on his big screen, whether it be college or pro, and he says, hey, what do you think about this, bro? I text it back. Hey, bro, it looks pretty good. We may put that one in. So I get constant coaching from Caden. We look forward to a lot of great things from Caden the next couple of years, and I appreciate his hard work. Look forward to working with him. All right, let's talk about our seniors. Matthew Stifler. Okay. Matthew's a young man that relocated from Fairhope, relocated to Fairhope, joined our team this past summer, did a great job for us, great kid to work with, didn't get a lot of PT, but he received 3 votes for captain, and that's a lot to be said for no longer than he was here, and he's going to Sterling College to continue his career in education in Kansas. All right, my dude, Riley, he needs no introduction.
My man, love you too, buddy.
Riley had an outstanding career, as we all know. His senior season saw him throw for over 2,000 yards, rush for over 500 yards, account for 25 touchdowns, sold 3 hot dogs and 32 bags of popcorn each game. He received numerous honors, everything from all-county to all-state. He was selected as the Coastal Alabama Athlete of the Year this past year, not only for his abilities in football, but basketball and track. Riley, as we all know, signed with Duke University on the December early signing date. The thing about Riley, he's a class act on the field, but he's a class act off the field. And mom and dad, y'all did a heck of a job raising that guy. He truly is a role model for all the youth in the city of Fairhope. And I'm going to get on my soapbox for just a second here, okay? You know, when you start selecting these all this and all that teams, you start selecting these all-star teams, various different kinds of all-star games, and it gets real political, particularly at the quarterback position. I will admit, this may be the most loaded class of quarterbacks in the state of Alabama there's been in the last 10, 15 years. Bunch of good ones. But I tell you this, you mark my word, been doing this for 40 years. That's the only quarterback in the state of Alabama that has a chance to play on Sundays one day. I can tell you that point blank. Thank y'all very much. Turn it over to our running back coach, Dr. Chuck Nelson.
Good evening. Like Coach said, I had the opportunity and the pleasure working with our running backs this year. If you're a real football fan, you know the way things have kind of changed lately. It used to be that the Heisman Trophy went to the best running back, right? That's the way it happened for a few years. Now it's gone to the quarterbacks and the receivers, you know, the sexy positions. The running backs are the guys that just pound their head up in there, play after play after play, until something breaks. They have to be tough. They have to be disciplined. They have to be very patient. So this is a good group we've got. Usually a lot of teams will have a big stable of running backs. Well, that's just not the way the game's played much anymore, so you pick a few good ones and you go with them. First of all, I'm going to start with our lower classmen and work our way up. Quaylen McCants, he's a little boy. Quaylen spent split his time this year between H-back, which is required to do a lot of blocking and every now and then getting the ball. But Quaylen is also a very good downhill runner at the running back position, and we're looking forward to big things from him. Quaylen's one of those guys you can put on either side of the ball, and he's going to be successful. He's just a football player. Who got over there? Next, Mr. Jackson Shores. Jackson spent his entire time at he started for us at the H-back position this year, did a great job. It's a job sometime that doesn't get your name in the paper a lot, but the people that get their name on the papers can thank him a lot for doing his job. And he's a tough player. We appreciate what he did. Great job. Mr. Glenn Patrick was a junior this year. These days, running back is not a one-man job. You have to have your breaks. You have to go and get your breath a little bit because you take such a beating. And it's so hard on you cardiovascular-wise. Glenn carried his share of the load this year, got a lot of carries, did a really good job. We're expecting really big things from him. He's really fast. We're still working on him catching the ball, but we'll figure that out when it gets there. And for our lone senior running back this year, Mr. Kylan Cohen. Yes, sir. Love you, buddy. Kylan this year, he did a fantastic job for us. He averaged a little over 5 yards a carry, which is saying a lot. If you do that over a career, which he did, it leads to big things. We have a lot to be thankful for with Kylan. His toughness. Kylan is one of those guys that, you know, winners want the ball, and he wants it every play, and every play is supposed to be a touchdown. We had to work on patience a little bit this year, but I love that about him because you'd much rather rein a player in than try to push him out. And he did a great job for us. And over his career, Kylan rushed for right around 1,300 yards and 19 touchdowns. at the running back position, which is a very solid 7A high school career. This year's running backs. And now I'll turn it over to our receivers coach, the Reverend Al Ernest.
Good evening. Honored to be here with you. And as Coach said, I was very blessed. Those of you that have been around a while know this is actually my second tour of duty here in Fairhope. And I feel very fortunate to be back here and working. So I'm going to go. We're going to go in order of class. We're going to go sophomores, juniors, and seniors. So the first guy I want to bring up right here, Colton Smith, sophomore. And I think what you just see right there says a lot about Smitty. Smitty's a guy everybody loves, always willing to do anything that'll help help his team and help his teammates. Next, Dax Lopez. Dax is a guy that continued to improve as he learned fundamentals, and looking forward to seeing him make great strides over the next couple of years. Next guy, Greg Bowman. Another guy, you know, again, a lot of young talent here, got better as he learned to do a lot of the little things that go into playing the position better, and did a good job for us. Next, Alex Penn. Alex, probably one of the best attitudes on our team. Again, a guy that works incredibly hard to do everything that you ask him to do exactly how you ask him to do it, and blessed to have Alex. Abe Solomon, another sophomore. One of the things when you play football, and you guys that have played know this, the scout team is never the most enjoyable place to be, but it's also a place where sometimes you get guys on the radar for the first time. And I know that's when I first noticed Abe, and he's a guy that just got better and better. And again, look forward to another sophomore that we're looking forward to having for the next two seasons. Next guy, Jack McCormick. Jack is one of those guys, I don't know if there's many guys that genuinely want to get better as much as he does. He's a guy that is always asking questions, and when you give him the information, he always tries to carry it forward and apply it. And another guy with a very bright future. Next guy, Ben Mosley. Again, another guy who got people's attention on the scout team, did a great job for us during the JV season, and another guy, again, I think that has an incredibly bright future. So we'll go now into our juniors. First guy, Carter Bossard. Incredible attitude. I've had the chance where I kind of stationed myself in our weight room. I usually see Carter in his group first, and I really love how he's working, really love the things he's doing to give himself an opportunity to compete next season. Next guy, Jack Bird, wins the Sharpest Dresser Award for tonight, I guess. Jack's a guy, when you talk about him, you're talking about a guy that's always accountable. You always know what you're going to get with him, and you're going to get his best every time he's out there, and he has all the tools, again, to be a guy that we can lean on. Next guy, Matt Hall. Matt was a guy that joined us late, transferred in from Kansas this summer, and really immediately got everybody's attention. Great skill set, and again, a guy that I think has another bright future. Next guy, DJ Harris. DJ was a guy was asked to change positions, did so willingly, without hesitation. Provided quality depth for us all year long, and another guy that we're excited to have for another year. Next guy, Trey Hawkins. Hawk is a guy that has a great future with us. We're excited about him. And he's one of those guys that if he can see, I think, a lot of times what other people see in him, he's gonna make incredible strides this season. Last junior, Pratt Turner. Pratt came here this year, transferred in from Baker, did a great job for us, had a huge play in the Alma Bryant game that kind of kick-started us at that time, and looking forward again to another season with him. All right, so we'll now go into our seniors. First guy I want to bring up, Chasen Letcher. Letch, as he is more affectionately known. Letch did a great job for us this year. Again, great team guy, incredibly unselfish, and contributed well this season. Zach Petrie, our next senior. Another guy that had to learn because of depth issues, had to learn multiple positions, and really did a good job for us. We're going to miss him around this place. So next guy is next senior, Ramon Bradley. Fat. All right, Fat, probably one of the most talented guys I've ever worked with. Finished the season 55 receptions, 867 yards, 11 TDs. Finished his career with 117 receptions for 1,997 yards and 16 TDs. Finished his Fairhope career with 2,340 total yards and 18 touchdowns. Probably the biggest game I'll remember with Ramon was over at Baker, where he jump-started us with a big kickoff return in the second half and really was instrumental in that particular win. Oh, man, this guy. Dre Matthews. Dre's one of those guys that always makes it fun out there. You never know what he's going to say, which makes things interesting, but it's usually something that's going to make you smile. Dre finished this season 37 catches, 381 yards, finished his career with 77 receptions for 1,032 yards and four touchdowns. Had a huge game against Central in the playoff game, 9 catches for 98 yards, and that's usually the mark of a great player, what you do against good people. Last guy, Grant Pfeiffer. Grant was a guy that probably, I know from the time that I joined the staff in midsummer, just came an incredibly long way, and by the end of the season was one of the most consistent guys we had, if not the most consistent. Finished the season with 20 receptions, 338 yards, 6 TDs. Finished his career with 27 receptions, 393 yards, and 7 TDs. And the play that I think I'll remember with Grant was the big 57-yard reception that iced the game against Spanish Fort in week one. He had a huge game. So, ladies and gentlemen, your 2020 wide receivers.
Vaughn Messina, I coach the offensive line. We're the guys that do all the work and don't get any glory. Every now and then, Coach Carter's nice enough to let us do a pat-and-go drill with a lineman run down the field and the quarterbacks throw him a ball. After landing a check in Azar's fifth or sixth drop, I said, let's go, let's get out of here. This ain't working. Let's go back and do what we do. So anyway, I'll start with the sophomores. Nate Casalo, by far the most improved offensive line, did a great job for us this year. Jacob Nothrop. Once I got Jacob's haircut straight, he improved a lot. Did well for us on the JV. Cameron Baker. Started every JV game for us at left tackle. Has a lot of potential with his footwork and did a great job on pass pro. Josh Gillen. Josh is a scrappy kid that fought, gave it everything he had on every drill every single day. Mickey Herrick. Battled through an injury early in the season, came back and gave us some really good reps on the JV. Hope he contributes this Friday, or this year on Friday nights. Marshall Azar. Marshall started every game at center on the JV, did a great job, and again, I'm expecting big things for him this year on Friday night. Juniors, Oscar Sandifer. You never know what condiment Oscar's going to bring to practice every day. He has his own way of having fun. He's the life of the OL. Love Oscar. He keeps getting better every day, and I think he's going to contribute this year on Fridays. Cooper Roberson. Cooper moved over from the D-line midway through the year. He was a little behind. Took him a second to learn everything. Once he got going, he did a really good job. Again, expecting him to help out big time on Friday nights this year. Spencer's the third cold closure we've had since I've been here. Another great kid, does a great job, got better as the season went on, and we're hoping for big things for him on Friday nights this year. Wesley Crabtree. Tremendous improvement from his sophomore to his junior year. Had to start versus Foley this year, and then the last two, three games of the season, he was in on some of our heavier packages. Logan Lanacek. I think Logan gets bigger every time I see him. That's a good thing. Had a breakout 2020 season. He started every game at right tackle for us. Showed signs of being a dominating force for the O-line. He had 12 pancake blocks on the season. Graded the highest in the OL after the Murphy game. Last junior is Owen Vanderwall. Owen's going on as a two-year starter. He's kind of my Mr. Do-It-All utility player. Dylan called him the OL dictionary because he knew what to do at every position. Overall, he was the highest graded offensive lineman on the season, and he led the unit with 16 pancakes this year. Not able to attend tonight was Ben Hoover. Ben started midway through his junior year and became a really good player for us. We were expecting great things from Ben this year, and unfortunately he had to have elbow surgery. And he missed the season. Ben was a great player, very undersized, but very scrappy. And we hope he recovers well from his elbow surgery and has a great baseball season this spring. Dylan Smith. Dylan rejoined us, came back to Fairhope after 2 years away. Tough, hard-nosed kid, played with an edge and got way better as the year went on. Didn't go through spring practice, so there was a big learning curve with the plays and just some of our drills. Started at left tackle for us, and his highest graded game was versus Alma Bryant at 85%. James Inman. James was a three-year starter for us. He is one of four seniors here tonight that started all three of his years playing varsity football. He battled through injuries both his junior and senior year, had a tough break midway through the season this year, but did a great job, came back, and was able to contribute the last two games versus Murphy and Central. Park Painter. What a great story Park is. If you don't know, he had a major surgery his freshman year, and really is just a miracle to be here, be with us, and to play football. An undersized fighter, a scrappy kid, hard nose, worked his tail off in the weight room for 2 years just to put himself in a position to play. Park, by his body stature, is really built for tackle. Because of injuries this year, I had to throw him in at guard. Never said a word, just sucked it up and did his job every week. He fought his tail off, did a great job all year, and I'm so proud of Park for everything he's accomplished and come through. Last is Jason Jarrell. Jason's the unquestioned leader on the offensive line. He leads us through our ladders and stretch routine every day. Some of our conversations and stretch always got interesting, but that's okay. Two-year starter at center, back-to-back years being all-county. His junior season, because of injuries and different situations, I had to move Jason to guard for one game. No complaints. No whys, he just sucked it up and did it. So proud of Jason. Again, he was the leader of the offensive line, undersized fighter and scrapper on the inside, and he always gave it his best every Friday night. Thank you. Defense. Now we'll recognize our defensive players.
All right, while they're making their way up to the stage here, I just want to say thank you. I want to say thank you to my brothers, the coaching staff, because without them, it's just, I can't do it without them. With me being the defensive coordinator, I just need them, and it's like, we go in, we change things from week to week, sometime, and they're always right there rolling with me every time, and I really, truly appreciate them. Next, I would like to say thank you to the players. Thank you for the challenges that we had to face. Thank y'all for persevering. Thank you for pushing through. Thank you, like my uncle would always say, rolling with the punches. He said, you always gotta be able to roll with the punches in life, and that's exactly what y'all did today, I mean this year, and I truly, truly appreciate it. My last thank you is I want to thank the parents. Thank you. Thank you for letting us coach your son. Thank you. Now, I'm going to introduce some players here. We're going to start with the sophomores. Right here we have Brooks Brasfield. Good young athletic corner. He's very coachable. He got better every day. He was always out there competing, always looking to try to get on the field. We always had to pull him back sometime. Like, Brooks, come on. Come on now. Come on. But I like it. I like somebody that wanted to get out there and compete. I like it a lot. Next, we got LaShavion Brown. Or Shay Shay. Shay Shay was cool as the other side of the pillow. He had a little knee issue early on when he had to have some surgery earlier this year, so he really couldn't get out there till late on in the year. But once he did, he came out there full speed. Even though he really couldn't quite go full speed, he still was trying. And I love that about him. He always competed, and that's what we love about Shay Shay. He got a bright future. He just got to keep working, getting stronger, getting better, and learning the system. And he's going to be a great player for us. Next player, Maddox Davis. Maddox is extremely, extremely coachable. I love him. I love him. He will run through a brick wall if you ask him to. You tell him to go pick some weeds, he is flying over there 100 miles an hour to pick it up. That's the type of kid that he is. He plays hard. He's a quick learner, very smart. He was kind of thrown in the fire a little bit. We don't like to really put our sophomores in positions where we got to baptized by fire, but he responded well. And I truly appreciate that about him. And he's going to be a good player for us, too, in the upcoming years. Next, we have Anthony Martinez. You talk about a selfless guy. There's been plenty of times we come back on Sunday, well, who are we going to get a scout team award to? And he would be the main person that everybody throwing their name out as far as always out there trying to get the best look. He knew his role. And we preach that to our kids sometimes. You got to know your role. Everybody can't go out there and start, but everybody's important to this team. And know your role and play it. And he did. And he was smart and intelligent. He kind of knew exactly what everybody was supposed to do in the secondary. And that's what I love about him. And he's going to be a good player for us. He just got to keep working, getting stronger. He's going to be great. But like I said, selfless player. And that's what you love about him the most. Next, we have Parker Nettles. And I want to say sorry, Parker, for always calling you Nelson for the longest. I did that often. Still kind of learning or whatnot, because with COVID hit and I didn't get the opportunity, like Coach said, to go through spring training and get to know the guys like that. But he kept looking at me. He never really corrected me, which I love, because I'm like, Parker, I'm always right. Make sure that, all right? Don't embarrass me. Pull me to the side. But he never got upset, and I appreciate it. Great guy. He always came to work, gave me 100% effort. He was always trying to get in there as well. I always had to kind of pull him back too as well, and I love that about Parker. All right, we started with the juniors now. We have Blaine Myrick. Myrick is instinctive, athletic, has a nose for the ball, very aggressive, everything that you love in a football player. Now, the thing about Myrick, he always wants to know the why. I'm sitting there telling him, like, okay, Myrick, you got deep third on this one. Well, What has he got? Well, what does the other safety got? Well, what does the linebacker do? He always wants to know why and where everybody fits. He wants to know the big picture, and I love that about him. And I thought we would have some friction. I'm like, Coach, I don't know, because he played a little receiver too initially. But then he bought in. And once he bought in, the sky was the limit. And I love him. He's going to be a great player for us too as well. Next person, Cody Brown. We got Big Hitter Brown. That's what I like to call him. We come in, going through the JV nights and whatnot, and you just see somebody come up, wow, who was that? Coach, that was Cody, woo. Love that about him. Big Hitter Brown, he was always there. He's unafraid to stick his nose in the hole, which we love that about him. We're gonna try to get him a little bit closer toward that ball next year so he can continue to stick that nose in that hole a little bit for us. Next person. Mason Fowler. Mason is extremely reliable, love him to death. He is a great person, always there. You can count on him 100% to be there and to be ready to go, giving 100% effort every day. I love that about Mason. He's got to keep working. He's going to be a great player for us, too, the next year. I just know it in my heart. Okay, next person we have is TJ Banks. Of course, you would know him. I like to call him Nina because he wore the number 9. Big athletic. He's a big hitter. You'll see him kind of come up and make a good play. And then, of course, he's going to let everybody know. He's going to find that camera and let everybody know that he made that play. We should love that about him. But sometimes we had to tell him, kind of, TJ, calm down now. Calm down just a little bit. But we love that about him. But he's got great range. He's going to be a good safety for us in the upcoming year. All right, last but not least, we have, for our juniors, we have Levi Hickman. This was our comic relief for the secondary right here. He always brought levity to the group here. We'd be going through drills or whatnot, and he has to crack a joke. He has to do this, and sometimes I would laugh and go along with it, and another time, I'm like, Levi, not right now. Come on, we got to put in work. It's Daphne week, you know? But I love that about him. Levi always wanted to know exactly, Coach, what can I do to get better? What did I do wrong? How can I do this? How can I do that? He was always willing to learn and get better, and that's what I love about Levi. He's going to be a good player for us next year. All right, now to the seniors. We have Tucker Klein. Tucker's been with us for 3 years now through the program, and we have big plans for Tucker this year, but he kind of got derailed a little bit with injuries. He always seemed to get hurt, and it's never in the game where it seemed like he always got hurt in practice, whether we're going through we going through some backpedaling drills, or I'm throwing a ball for high point drills. He always come down, hit his shoulder or something. It's like Tucker. But he was always there. I can't say that. He never stopped showing. I mean, he always showed up for practice. He always showed up, and he was truly reliable, and I love him there for it. So much that I asked Tucker to be on the bowling team. Now, Tucker ain't never bowled in his life, and if you ever watched him bowl, you would know that he never bowled in his life. But he was reliable, and that's what I needed. And he's always been there for us, and I appreciate you, Tucker, and I love you. Next person, Katie Norrell, 3-year player for us, too. Caden always has this smile or smirk on his face, and you never know if he's agreeing with you, mocking you, or just happy to be there that day. But you do love that about him, and he got better. He really kind of came into his own this senior year, and he started making some plays for us. And the play that sticks out when it comes with Caden, when he we're playing Murphy, and he gets the pick at the last game. And the first thing, he takes about 2 steps, and the first thing he does is start looking back for somebody to come tackle him instead of just running the ball straight ahead as far as it can get. So I'm sure he'll remember that for the rest of his life. But I want to thank you, Caden, all right, for sticking it out with me. I want to thank you for being there for the team and always stepping in when we needed you. Last but not least, we have Chapman Hartley. This is my utility guy. Chapman has played corner. He has played safety. He has played Sam linebacker, outside linebacker. He probably would have played DN if we would have asked him to. He would have been at the nose if we would have asked him to. That's just the guy. He is selfless. He played 100%, gave 100% effort every time. He never complained. And he was a really smart, intelligent football player. And I love that about him. Great team guy, always willing to go the extra mile to help us out. He always kind of kept me on track. If something didn't make sense, he was like, "Coach, you sure about that?" And I'm like, "Wait a minute. Yeah, you're right. All right, let's take that and make sure." He always kept me on my toes, and I love that about him, because sometimes you need it as a coach. The players kind of check you a little bit to make sure that you haven't, you know, messed them up or screwed them up. But he did it in the right way. He always did it behind closed doors, which is the best way. So I appreciate you, Chapman. I'm sorry. I appreciate you, Chapman. I love you. And thank you. Thank you for your service to Fairhope High School. Next, we're going to go with the linebackers.
Thank y'all for being here. We're going to call him out. I'll talk at the end when the seniors come. But the first guy we got is Parker Beach. Parker showed up Monday and took prize for the best mullet I've ever seen. He works his butt off, and he's one of our Mike linebackers, and he's absolute joy to be around, and I can't wait to help him reach some of his goals as we work towards next season. Next, we have Evan McKenzie. This was my first year getting to meet Evan, getting to work with him, and it's been great to have him whenever we could tear him away from aviation school to come to practice a little bit, and he played his heart out on the JV level for us, and he showed his ability that he could potentially help us in the future, and he's just great to be around. Next, we got Hunter Hughes. Hughes is one that doesn't get away from me often. We just left baseball practice to come here today, and I'm sure he was getting tired of hearing me yell. But Hunter's a first-year varsity player, and I enjoyed having him as a part of our group. He pushes himself to practice, and it shows by his efforts on and off the field. And I look forward to seeing him grow in the future as well. Next, we got Rogers. Unfortunately, he had to cut his mullet off too, but it was glorious, wasn't it, Rogers?
Yes, sir.
He's an absolute joy to be around. I can't say enough about him. He's another one that's with me on the afternoons at baseball now too. But he's a great teammate, and I can't wait to have him again next year. Next, we got Corey Davoli. He started at Mike linebacker for us. He started at Mike linebacker for us, and I don't know if I've ever met somebody that has a better personality for the position. He's always going to want to be tougher, meaner, and more determined than anybody he goes up against, and I guarantee you nobody lining up across from him wants it more than him. It's been a blast helping him improve his game, and I just can't wait once again to see what happens as we move through the summer and into next year. Now for our juniors, we got Colton Brown. He's one of the hardest working people you've ever seen, and that's on the football field and out of it. He's working constantly. He's always looking to better himself when he makes mistakes and pushes himself way past his abilities, and he just forces himself to be better. I'm excited to see him step into a leadership role for us next year as some of these seniors move on, and I can't wait for it. Next, we got Luke Manasco. Luke's one of the strongest kids we've got on the team, and I enjoy having him as a part of our group. And I can't wait to see him transfer some of that strength that he has in there to the weight room as he once again steps into a leadership role for us. Next, we got Helwege. Joseph Helwege. Now, Helwege is an absolute joy to be around. Absolutely. He's the funniest person, one of them you've ever met, and he absolutely picks up my spirits every day, and I enjoyed having him because he made my days better out there. Sometimes they can get long, and he just made it better being around him. Just like the rest of these juniors, I look forward to seeing them embrace the challenge of raising the standards for success that these guys that I'm about to talk about have set for them to follow. The first guy we have is Jonathan Klontch. It was my first year with Klontch, but I loved it, and unfortunately, he got injured once again, and that's kind of been his story. But it's been a blast getting to talk to him, getting to know him, and seeing him out there skateboarding after the season got done. I think I see him more now than I ever did before. The next guy we have is Dylan Roberts. If y'all didn't know this, Dylan is TikTok famous. He went viral there for a little while. But he's another one that I've loved to be around, loved getting to know, and I'm going to talk a lot about him as a group in a minute. But he was our starting soundbacker, and he made plays well above his ability, and that goes to show his determination that he had all year. Next, we got Brian Sledge. Now, I'm going to tell you, I coached Brian when he was a linebacker. Then he went to corner, and then he went back to linebacker and anywhere in between. He would do anything that we asked him to do, and that would even be on a single day we were asking him to play multiple positions, and he never checked up, and he gave everything he had, and it goes to show some of the plays he made in big games for us. Next, we got Hayden Phillips. Hayden's a guy that's been with us for a while, and he's another one that I got every day during fourth period, and I'm sure, or during baseball as well, and I'm sure he's definitely got tired of listening to me. But these seniors here, these are guys that I've had come through, and they've been the first group that I've had since their freshman year. And it says a lot about them as players and people, because being around me isn't great all the time. You can ask a few of them. They take it all in stride and do the best they can, and anything we've asked them to do, they've done it to the best of their abilities. I'd have never imagined that when these guys came to our program as freshmen, they would have such an impact on the program from the defensive side of the ball. But they've worked their butts off, and they've never complained and gave everything they had when they were on the field at any position. The most rewarding part for me, though, is getting to know them off the field. It's getting to see them build their character, leadership skills, and the way they improved from year after year and gave everything they had. I didn't tell them as much as they should, but they absolutely know that I love them. I'd do anything for them, and I can't wait to see what happens as they move on with their lives. Without these guys, our success would have been a lot harder to come by and a lot less enjoyable for me. And thank you for allowing me to be part of your lives for the last 4 years. I really appreciate it. And the best of luck to you seniors as you begin to plan for your future after Fairhope High School. Always remember, you got me in your corner, and I love you to death. Thank you, guys. That's our linebackers. We'll move to our D-line, our interior lineman.
Good evening. How are y'all? I'm going to try to keep this a little bit quicker than some of the others. They're a little bit smarter than me, I guess. My name's Coach McDonald. I coach D-ends. So we'll start with the sophomores. D-ends, first up, Holland Brock. Holland is a hard-working player that's very coachable. He came to us. He was kind of doing offense and defense. He came to us and very coachable, and you tell him to do it, and he's trying to change it the next play. So that's very nice. I look forward to having him the next couple of years. Next up, John Harper. John played both offense and defensive lines for us, mostly O-line. Just out of necessity, he would come to us when we could get him. JV games and all, he was always ready to be thrown in whenever. A lot of times we would go over stuff on the board the day of, and he did really well in it. So hopefully we keep him on the D-line a little more at the end spot. That is our sophomore D-ends. Next up, our junior D-ends. Start with big Ronnie Maggio. Ronnie played tight end on offense, and then on defense he played both inside and out. Did really well for us. He's working his tail off in the weight room, and we look for big things from him next year. Next up is Nash Hamrick. Nash spilt coffee on himself in my first period class this morning. Didn't clean it up, but told me he did. Got, I think, all the way to his truck. Did you get to your truck? Got all the way to his truck, and I made Mason call him. and tell his butt to come back and clean it up because I was pissed off. But he came back. When he walked in, we clapped for him. Try to embarrass him, but Nash is always full speed, gives you everything he has. He's played multiple places on the D-line, even at times inside with that killer physique and that awesome pass rush that he has. Okay, next up is Trent Spaller. Trent had a great year for us. He started a few games, got banged up, but was always in the rotation, always in. I think he actually had an interception. Is that right, Trent? We had one interception? Trent, one interception? Okay, all right, just making sure. Most people remember that. But anyway, Trent always gives us his all, always looking to help wherever he can, special teams, anywhere on the D-line, wherever we ask him to go, he goes. So that's Trent. Next up is Elijah Webb. Eli came on strong this year, earning a starting spot close to midway through the year. He works out really hard. He trained like crazy to get in shape. He also got in real good shape from all the extra boards and suicides that he had at times from being silly. And seems like he's always wrestling somebody, Manasco or somebody. So anyway, came in always full speed at practice, even though we might be going half speed or sometimes even a walkthrough. Eli's full speed, so we got to watch him and make sure you don't take somebody out. We look for big things from him next year as well. Last for the junior class is Owen Baldino Williams. Owen came in for us, had all-season foot surgery. Did well for us, battling back from that. I found out his middle name is Baldino, and I'm like, why have we been calling you Owen for so long? Because I just think Baldino's an awesome name. So at times I say, are you playing like Owen or are you playing like Baldino? Baldino just sounds like a, you know, bad name. So, but he came back from foot surgery, battled back, helped us on the D-line as well as special teams throughout the year. We look forward to this junior class leading us next year at the DN spot. My one and only senior is Kirk Lipscomb. If you're wondering, this is how Kirk stands sometimes. And anyway, I love this dude to death. I love this dude to death. Kirk played 2-year starter for us at DN, played hard every Friday night, gave you everything he had, fought through shoulder injuries. At times I would get on to him and he's like, Coach, I can't get my shoulders out, and it's hanging. I'm like, whatever, you missed the tackle, that's why it's hanging, you know. And it really would be out. But Kirk gave us everything he had last year. This past year toward the end of the year was playing his best ball, even with the bum shoulders. Kirk always has a way of making you smile, even though a lot of times you're kind of pissed off at him. So I don't know how he does it, but you're just as mad at him for doing something and you're just smiling the whole time you're mad at him. So Kirk just went on an official visit today. I'm good with this? Okay. Official visit today and got an offer to play at the next level at West Alabama. So that is the DNs for Fairhope. Thank y'all.
Yeah, I'm glad Kirk got that offer today. That's my alma mater, and I called the Texas head coach. I'm like, you finally recruited one of my guys after 15 years of knowing where I'm coaching anyways. But I'm glad for Kirk you back there. For those who don't know, I'm Brett Horn. I'm the defensive tackles coach. This has been a great group to coach. We had some ups and downs. We have some of the more interesting characters of the team on our side of the ball. Yeah, hi, Jerry. Jerry hasn't had himself heard in 30 minutes, so you have to forgive him. But anyways, it's a fun group to coach. I apologize. I don't have nice, pretty notes like everybody. I do everything off the cuff, like my wife wants me to get better at that, but I'm trying. We're going to start off with our two sophomores. First of all, we got Bella Brickman. Now, Miller is probably one of our most intelligent offensive linemen, as well as the most, I respect him because he's always, yes, sir, no, sir. He just looks at me, yes, sir, no, sir, yes, sir, no, sir. And no matter if it's good or bad, I don't know if he's mad at me or if he's intimidated or something, but he does a great job. He listens to everything I say. You know, I know if I put him somewhere, he's going to go to the right spot where sometimes I can put some of them in and they may go left, right, you know, any which way but loose. But I know when Miller comes in, he's a very dependable kid, and he's going to do what he's supposed to do. So looking forward to him for the next 2 years to see what he can do for us there. All right. Next up, we have Hudson Ruffner. Wait. Now, the story with the finger in the air goes, one day Hudson was injured, and being the nice, compassionate coach I am, I was like, get up, Hudson. You're fine. You're good. Let's go. And he just goes. And he did get injured that day, and I felt horrible about it. But, you know, he kept him out for a few weeks. But, you know, one thing, Hudson, he came back in towards the end of the year and got to practice and got back in the groove. And he'll forever be known as the first person to look at me and go, hopefully the last. But anyways, these are our two sophomores this year. Looking forward to a couple more years with them. Next up, with that wonderful introduction, we have the infamous Cam Anderson. Now, come here, I guess. I'm going to say this about Cam. Cam as a sophomore was, had some improvements to make. And his jump from his sophomore to junior year, I would say he was the most improved defensive tackle we had. He made enormous leaps and bounds from what he was to what he is today. His speed's still about a 74, but he's working on it. So we love him. As you can see, he's a great kid because everybody on the team loves him. I love him and look forward to having him next year as one of the big dog seniors. So we'll see how that goes. Next, we have the infamous Garrison Gilmore. I don't want to hug you. You'd be lucky to get that. Now, Garrison, you know, you look at him, you go, he's a defensive tackle. But he is. He does a great job. I would always put him in and say, hey, Garrison, you're playing nose guard today. Hey, Garrison, you're going to be the junk today. Hey, you might play end today. And he would just kept plugging him in different spots, and he would do a very good job at no matter where I put him. Hey, we're doing third long situation. You're in the game. Sometimes Coach Carter would go to look and Gilmore in the game. I'm like, yep, Gilmore's in the game. But he did a great job every time he was in the game and produced for us. And next year, look forward to putting him in three or four different spots again and finding his niche where he could have a chance to help us and start and really contribute to the football team for next year. And he did a great job this year. Garrison Gilmore. All right. I think I have the biggest group of seniors. So we're going to start this off right with John Anderson. John kept moving around. He came to us this year from the O-line in a trade for a player to be named Lair. And we were excited to get him. John was always did a lot of extra. He lost a lot of weight and really trimmed up to the man he is today. He was always out to practice running and doing extra things. Had some injuries here and there. But, you know, I knew one thing when John was there, he was going to give 100% no matter where he was. He'd get up and he may be running and may go to the left and the ball to the right, but he was going somewhere to get there eventually. So, John Anderson. Malik Hoyt, our Jamaican transplant. Yaman. All right. Malik came to us as a lonely sophomore from Jamaica. When we said, come play football, he thought soccer. So he came to us, and Coach Carter said, hey, you got this guy. He's got good feet and can run. And he did not have a clue what to do. That was 3 years ago. fast forward 3 years later, and he would show glimpses of just coming off the ball and hitting people and knocking people back. But you know, Malik always has a smile on his face. You know, he was always happy. Going to pick him up with some workouts. But hey, coach, how's it going? You know, I just enjoyed being around him, and I'm gonna miss his just big smile every day of practice. You know, when he just, hey, coach. You know, that's kind of how he was. Malik Hoy. All right, Dorian Penn. Give me a hug. See, I have a soft side. Dorian, my neighbor right now, you know, he went through a lot of ups and downs, and really found his niche on our team. And, you know, I'm proud that Dorian is where he is today. He could have quit. He had every opportunity and probably a lot of reasons to do it. But Dorian stuck it out, and I think he's going to be a better man for it. And he really did help us. We found a niche for him. You know, we put him in different places in a different packages. You know, I remember when all the COVID stuff hit, we were at home one day, and I started driving around my neighborhood. And I'm like, there's Dorian. I'm like, Dorian, what are you doing here? I live right there. I'm like, oh, now you're my neighbor. So now my wife made me go buy him some ice cream. So, she's going to kill me. But I really and truly, I'm proud because Dorian stuck it out and, you know, it really helped us. And I think, honestly, he's going to be a great man for it. All right. Hagen Bruiser Ludrew. Now, I failed as a coach by getting him to get a haircut. But Bruiser, you know, starred for us for 2 years. Started for us for 2 years. Should have played more as a sophomore, but the dumb coach didn't put him in enough. But, you know, Bruiser was, you know, you weren't going to move Bruiser. He was two tree trunks. It didn't matter if it was two people on him, three people on him, four people. He just wasn't moving, okay? And from his junior to senior year, he figured out how to attack people and cause even more chaos in the backfield. And, you know, good Lord. And we are really going to miss his presence in the middle because he just, you know, probably one of the most solid nose guards we've ever had here at Fairhope in the 10 years I've been here, nine coaching defensive line. He just, you know, he's grown up. He's maybe not pound for pound, but he is the strongest player on our team by far, you know, watching all the accomplishments in the weight room as he's very proud of. And he should be because he's worked hard. And, you know, I watched with his dad throughout the years growing up from talking about Bruiser, and I'd always see him Little League camps. I'm like, one day he'll be with me. And then when he got there, I'm like, wow, I am glad he's here. So we're going to miss you, Bruiser. Now, the man that really needs no introduction, but I'm going to do it anyways, Jerry Lepay. Now, everybody in here knows Jerry. They've heard Jerry. They've seen Jerry. Let me give it a hug. And they've seen him on the football field, probably one of the better players that's ever come through Fairhope High School, at least the 10 years I've been here. You know, but one of the things I am going to tell you about Jerry, and most of you all already know this, as big and bad and loud and sometimes obnoxious, it's okay, as he could be, he probably has one of the biggest hearts of any football player I've ever had. I can always say my children, you know, and a lot of other children on our staff will always come home, and no matter how mad I am at them, how'd Jerry do today? He did great. He did great, sweetheart. Are you mad at Jerry? No, I'm not mad at Jerry. Why'd you yell at Jerry Friday? I don't know, baby. It's okay. But his heart is bigger than his athletic ability, which is a lot as well. And I know Fairhope is going to miss him because good and better things are coming for him in the near future. I know it deep in my heart because he deserves it. And, I still hope he comes around, you know, I even tried to help basketball so I can have him sit next to me most of the time and I can still have conversations with them. But we're going to miss you, Jerry, and the rest of you guys. Hi, Jerry. Like you're ever going to go away for me. But anyways, love you guys. The last year's defensive tackles.
While our kickers come over, I want to mention a couple other people that I've saved them for this moment. Gavin Willison, if you'll stand up back there. Ryan Smith. I cannot tell you the impact and the importance of those two guys in our program and their sacrifice to these kids for no monetary exchange, no nothing, other than that they love working with young people and they have made a tremendous impact, and I'm glad to call them a part of the program. Another guy I want to mention is Mark Seeley. I see he made it tonight. Mark, stand up for a second. Absolutely loves Fairhope more as much as anybody I've ever seen. He wanted to coach this year. I think there was two hurricanes that landed ashore. He made a job change and just never really could get any momentum about being able to get away. I know he's working all the time, but he's also a very important person to us. I now want to mention our kickers. I'm going to take credit for them. Ryan McNeil is our first guy. He's in the 10th grade. Great leg, and he's gaining confidence and a pretty good athlete. So, he's going to be heir apparent down the road. Another junior is Tony Palumbo. Tony Palumbo is... He's a great guy. He really is. We have him as an A fifth period, and he is just a guy that's willing to do whatever you ask him. But I'm gonna tell you what, he's a really good athlete. He's gonna run track, and he has the distinction of being in the same class with Luke Freer. And you know, he was our backup this year. He got a couple kicks in games, but he's also a guy that's ready to go if we ever need him. Next guy, Luke Freer. You know, Luke never kicked until I think it was the 10th grade. He came out. He earned our kickoff position, but couldn't punt a lick. And after his sophomore season, he dedicated himself and he worked the entire offseason. I've never seen a guy work that hard. He was up there all the time. He and a guy by the name of Sam Rayburn that used to kick for us, and he turned himself into a punter. Now he can do both. He averaged almost 40 yards per punt this year, and he kind of just worked his way into it. He kicked 85% of his kickoffs in the back of the end zone to not be returned. That's a great weapon. He was 100% in his extra point tries, 39 of 39 in his career here. And also, he was 70% on his field goals. The last game, he missed two, which really upset him. But I would come over and say, you're a guy, man. Keep your head up. So that's our kickers. We got them all back, and we're excited about them for next year. Thank you. Next is a group of unsung heroes, because they do everything from get water ready at practice. They're there for our players, and that's our trainers. Caitlin Hunter is the first one. Kendall McCovery. And this year, Gage Copeland. These three were willing to do whatever. Gage is going to play football next year, but they were very valuable to us, and Marley and Josh were grateful for them, so we were glad to have them as well. All right. To make this a little quicker and just to kind of just, but I wanted these guys to be recognized. We've had some honors that have been bestowed upon members of our football team this year. I'm going to run down a list, and they're just going to, I want you to, if I call your name, stand up at your seat. Hold your applause to the end, please, because it's quite a list right here. First of all county selections. Honorable mention, Kirk Lipscomb, Hayden Phillips, Corey Davoli, Grant Pfeiffer, Owen Vanderwall, Logan Lanichek, Dylan Smith, Kylan Cohen, Chapman Hartley. Guys, stand up. Stay standing. First and second team selections, Riley Leonard, Ramon Bradley, Dre Matthews, Jason Jarrell, Luke Freer, Jerry Bethay, Hagan LeDrew, TJ Banks. Give them a round of applause. All coastal team. First team, Ramon Bradley. First team, Luke Freer. First team, Jerry Bethay. Second team, Logan Lanichek and Riley Leonard. You guys stand up. Coastal Alabama Player of the Week, Riley Leonard. All-State, honorable mention, Logan Lanichek. Second team, Riley Leonard. First team, Luke Freer, Ramon Bradley, and Jerry Bethay. Give them a hand. Selection to the North-South game, Jerry Bethay. So far, scholarship recipients, Jason Jarrell, Birmingham Southern. Matt Stifler to Sterling College. Ramon Bradley to Mississippi Gulf Coast. Kirk Lipscomb to University of West Alabama. And Riley Leonard to Duke University. All A's Club. This is one I'm most proud of. Sophomores, Marshall Azar, John Harper, Maddox Davis, Hunter Hughes, Ryan McNeil, Matt Young, Jack McCormick, Nate Casalo, Abe Solomon. Stand up. Juniors, Logan Lanichek, Glenn Patrick, Luke Freer, Eli Webb, Matt Hall. Stand up. Seniors in the All-A Club, Grant Pfeiffer, Riley Leonard, Kylan Cohen, Chapman Hartley, Ben Hoover, and Dylan Roberts. Give them a hand. At this time, we're going to play our senior video.
Thought you'd get. decide how the rest is gonna read. Up a pen and a page, and I started writing just what I'd say if we were face to face. I tell you just what you mean to me, tell you these simple truths. Be strong in the Lord and never give up hope. You're gonna do great things. But don't forget why you're here. Take your time and pray. These are the words I would say. Last time we spoke, you said you were hurting, and I felt your pain in my heart. I want to tell you, keep on praying, love will find you where you are. I know, 'cause I've already been there, so please hear these simple truths. Be strong in the Lord and never give up hope. You're gonna do great things, I already know. God's got his hand on you, so don't live life in fear. Forgive and forget, but don't forget why you're here. Take your time and pray. These are the words I would say. From one simple life to another, I will say, come find peace in the Father. You're gonna do great things. I already know. God's got his hand on you, so don't live life in fear. Forgive and forget, but don't forget why you're here. Take your time and pray.
If our seniors would come on up. They've got a few gifts for them and just some things, some keepsakes. So, oh, come on up, spread across the back. Come on. Jason, walk up.
Yeah, go ahead and hand them stuff.
We've gotten a couple of keepsakes for them. The first of all is a frame that hopefully they'll be able to hang in their office one day and have as a keepsake with their name and their jersey logo on the back. Also got some pictures that the church provided through Miss Pippin that we're very proud of. And then they've got a pullover that we wanted to share. Coaches are kind of divvying those out. Give them just a second because I want their attention. All right. You know, this is a moment every season that's kind of a bittersweet. You know, they've been with us for a long time. We've had quite a few ball games we were a part of. This group will finish some of their accomplishments. They finished the regular season this year at 8-2. Their two losses came to 2 9-1 teams. Their overall record in their three-year period here is 21-12. Three straight playoff appearances, and in the county they were 2-1 versus Daphne, 3-0 versus Foley, and 1-0 versus Spanish Fort, who are probably considered our rivals. Tonight, when the season began, we challenged them to go from good to great. In several arenas, in several areas, I think we did. We had successes, and at times we had some shortcomings. But we persevered through those tough times. Coach Ernest yesterday during his Bible study shared a verse from James 1:12. Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial because, having withstood that test, he will receive a crown of life that the Lord has promised him to those who love him. You were given unusual circumstances. I have never seen some of the circumstances you faced in all of my career that had nothing to do with playing football, but you hung in there. There is greatness in all of you. I believe that. You've got to find your passion and make a positive impact somewhere and strive to help others. It may happen when you're young in life, like when Martin Luther King was preaching in Montgomery as a young man and a civil rights dispute fell on his doorstep. It may happen later in life, in a different area, like when Sam Walton was 44 years old, failing in business and opened this idea called Walmart. I don't know. I don't know when it'll come. Find your passion and strive for greatness. I love you. Thank you for your efforts, guys.
Love you too, Coach.
Give my hand.
Hey, he didn't say go Pirates. He didn't say go Pirates. Hey. Now.
They all have a gift that they're now taking to thank the cheerleaders for their efforts this year and appreciation. And I've got one other thing that I want to present real quick. We don't do a lot of awards. We do let the team pick a captain or captains. All our guys on our team vote for this. And after tallying the votes, it was very obvious that we had two guys that they all recognize as being our captains. I would like to recognize Jerry Bethay and Riley Leonard. All right, is that good?
If I were to sit up here and say, talk about how great Fairhope football is as a program, I'd be up here for hours. So, you know, I got a limited time, so I'll try to make it quick. We were blessed to even have a season this year. You know, a lot of kids around the country don't even get a chance to play this year. So, you know, we try to take everything as a blessing and, you know, cherish every day we had. Thank you to Fairhope Baptist Church for hosting us tonight. Thank you to everybody behind the scenes, chain crew, press box, athletic trainers, Ms. Pippen for everything that you do for our team, and the man who bleeds blue and gold, Mr. Charlie. Our memories at Major Field wouldn't be possible without you and your dedication to the sport that we love. Walking into the stadium filled with great people is something that we'll miss the most. Thank you to the parents as well for your constant love and support. At this stage in our life, it's kind of hard to express our feelings to you. So I challenge everybody on the team after this to hug your parents and tell them how much you love them. To the coaches, thank you so much for all your support. A lot of you guys are father figures in our life. I see Coach Horn and Jerry's relationship that, you know, it's grown over the past couple years. Thank you, Coach Carter, for everything you've done. Coach Williams, after the many, many years of coaching that you've done, you know, you've already forgotten more than a lot of us will ever learn, so I appreciate you a lot. to the sophomores and juniors, I'm going to miss you guys on the field and in the locker room. You guys are some of the hardest working groups I've ever played with. And I pray that what you guys remember about us won't be on the field, but it'll be off the field and all the things that we've done for you guys. As we all know, football doesn't last forever, but the relationships you make with your teammates will. So I pray that, you know, everything will go well next year and COVID will be ended with. And go Pirates.
All right. Even though we were not blessed with the best of luck in 2020, our coaches and our team worked very hard to overcome the setbacks and loss of time due to the coronavirus. Everyone had to buy in and do their part, unsure if we were ever even going to be able to have another season as a Fairhope Pirate. Throughout the summer, our team continued to work hard, and we could feel the atmosphere changing as we got closer and closer to game time. One of my most memorable games is our season opener this year against Spanish Fort. Knowing that we were never promised a season, it was very rewarding to be able to play with my boys again. Emotions were very high when we stepped off the bus and onto the field as seniors. It was bittersweet knowing that it was our last first game. That night, we defeated the Toros 45-34, and we celebrated like we had just won the Super Bowl. Throughout the entire season, we had many young guys step up and fill roles. I want every sophomore on the team to know how big a role they played, whether you were one of the guys who got to step out and actually play on Friday nights, or you a guy who worked their butt off every practice on the scout team. All you helped the team in a tremendous way. With y'all spring football approaching, know that none of y'all are ever too young to step up and be a leader and make an impact on everyone around you. Over the past year, this team has been through many ups and downs, but we always stayed together and unified, focused on one goal, good to great. All of us had always known that we were a good football team, but we wanted to make it a point to strive for greatness in the weight room, on the practice field, and in the classroom. I know at the end of the season, many seniors were disappointed that we were not able to reach the greatness of winning a state championship, but in time, I realized that greatness is not something that can just happen. It has to be worked on for years. So the habits of hard work and dedication we had this year will not just leave with us. It will be handed down from class to class, all trying to finish what we started in good to great. Being part of this program for the past 4 years has taught me numerous life lessons I will carry with me forever. Some of my most important memories have been made on this team with the guys in this room. Thank you for everyone who helped me get to this point, and I wish the best of luck for you juniors and sophomores, and I appreciate everyone who came out tonight to support Fairhope football. Once a Pirate, always a Pirate.
I wanted to take the time to thank all of our coaches. Not only do you teach us about football, but also life lessons such as leadership, teamwork, endurance, commitment, accountability, and goal setting. These lessons stay with us for life, even after football is over. For this, we appreciate y'all very much. Each and every coach has had to do so much extra over this COVID break, and had to put in so many extra hours, not only on the football field, but also in the classroom. All the Pirates and I realized that coaching adds a lot of hours to an already full job. This past year has been so different and extremely difficult during COVID, and I know I'm not only speaking for myself, but also for my teammates when I say that I am thankful and feel so blessed that we are able to have a football season this year. I also wanted to thank all the coaches, spouses, and their families for the love and sacrifices y'all have made. I know that at times athletes and fans don't realize how much you sacrifice to allow your husband or father to coach and minister to us. At times, you are both mom and dad to your kids, holding down the fort, getting them to their events, helping with homework, and making dinner. God sees your sacrifices and what you do behind the scenes, and he knows what you have to do so your spouse can be the best coach he can be. Thank y'all. You took all the pieces and personalities and built us into a working team. Thank y'all for all the hours you spent building up our strengths and minimizing our weaknesses. You've always seen not what we are, but what we could become. You've always instilled a part of our heart, your heart in ours. As we travel on to adulthood, we will always have warm memories of our time together. Thank y'all and go Pirates.
I got you. Watch this right here. Good evening, everybody. Good evening. I just want to personally thank everybody for attending this event tonight. And I just want to thank everybody who helped make this thing happen. Because, you know, with COVID and everything, we probably wouldn't have it. I didn't think we were going to have it, but we had it. But today, I'm going to talk about my head coach, Coach Carter. As you all know, Coach Carter's name is Timothy Carter. I broke his name letter by letter. I got some big words I'm going to say, so stick with me. The T stands for tenacious. Coach truly believed in each and every one of his players, and he isn't one to give up until the job is done. I don't know. Leave me alone. The I stands for intelligent. I can promise you any player that has ever asked Coach Carter for help with history was stuck in his office for at least 3 hours listening about every battle there ever was. The M stands for motivating. Whenever practice was moving kind of sluggish, Coach would bring us all together and look us in the eyes. He could say, we can pick this up or we can run the entire time. Y'all would have thought we were the track team the way we started moving around practice field. The C stands for competitive. Coach loved the thrill of the game and loves winning. Losing is never in his mind unless we're talking about a couple pounds. The A stands for accountable. Coach held us accountable for our actions on and off the field. The R stands for rewarding. Every time we did our job and reaching our goals on game days, Coach fed us pizza, so you know the fat boys are happy. The T stands for team player. Coach helped us build a relationship with each other that could never be replaced. The E stands for effort. Coach made sure each player gave their best on and off the field, and I kind of just said that, so don't laugh at me, I got it. And the R stands for respected. Coach Carter was very well respected around Fairhope, and nobody ever dared to backtalk him unless, yeah. He's a very well respected man. I love you all, good night.
Miss Pippin, I have a gift for you. Unlike all the other dudes, I don't have any paper that I'm reading off of, so I'm kind of winging it here. But if y'all know how much Miss Pippin does for us, she does a lot. Making the videos before the games on every Friday, and filming, and just doing everything that she can do for us. And people don't see that a lot. People don't see the back, like the things that happen in the background that she gets done. So we wanted to thank you.
All right, get the awards and tell me the names. Hey, coaches, can you come over here, please? Right there, go grab them. Grab the awards. I got you, coach. Don't worry about this. I'll take care of them.
spot?
To Coach Williams.
I got Coach Horn.
Coach Warner.
Coach Mack.
I got Coach Ernest.
Coach Nelson and Coach Smith.
Coach Smith?
Yeah, I'll take two.
No, not for you.
That's front.
I got Coach Willison.
He said what? He said whose name is Chapman?
Coach Carter.
Thank you, players. We appreciate that. Again, thank you for tonight. If you made all county, I need you to come down so we can get a picture made. We'll have things, guys. We have our websites up that you can stay tuned to Fairhope information. Please, as we know, spring dates and summer calendars, we're going to get those out to you. Thank you so much, and go Pirates. Senior players, your banners are in the lobby. Don't forget them. Your banners are in the lobby.
All county, please come up here for a quick picture before you leave.
I don't know. We lost them.